Yeah, good evening everyone. Welcome to the next session of the Sports Data Warehousing. So yeah, in this session we discuss OLAP and OLAP operations. What is OLAP and what are the different operations in OLAP? Before discussing OLAP, I would like to discuss the topics which were yet to discuss in the previous session. Is it fine now? Okay. Yeah. So let me just quickly open that slide, PPT. So I was discussing type 5. So type 5 is mini dimension and type 1 outrigger. So I've already explained the concept of mini dimension. Why do we create a separate dimension, mini dimension? Am I audible? Or is it still feeble? Let me check. So I was discussing type 5 mini dimension and type 1 outrigger, which is a combination of 4 plus 1. So for type 4 is mini dimension and type 1. So when you do the summation of type 4 and type 5, then you will get when you do the summation of type 4 and type 1, you will get type 5. So 5 is a summation of 4 plus 1. So type 4 is creating a mini dimension. Now, what is a mini dimension? I've already explained you why do we create a mini dimension in order to get rid of the monster dimension. Our big data analytics chapter T2, chapter 21, part of mid semester. No, it's not a part of your mid semester. Yeah, I have increased the volume. Guys, is it still feeble? Okay. Yeah. So I was explaining mini dimension in type 1 outrigger. So in type 5, we have it's a combination of mini dimension and outrigger. So I've already explained the concept of mini dimension as well as outrigger. So outrigger is a view. So in type 5, we create an outrigger as well as mini dimension in order to get rid of monster dimension. And mini dimension is connected with the base dimension via fact table. So the, we cannot directly join these two tables, customer table and this mini dimension table. We need to go via fact table. So here we have a base table as well as mini dimension. And here we create an outrigger which points to the current record, right? And this is of type 1 outrigger. Type 1, if I say type 1, what do you mean by type 1 outrigger? Type 1 outrigger is a record is there in the table whenever there is any change in any attribute value of this table, then we simply override that value rather than creating a separate row in the table in order to maintain the changes, right? So this is of type 1. Now the question is why we are maintaining this outrigger of type 1, why not type 2 outrigger? And if this outrigger is of type 2, then what are the challenges or what are the disadvantages of creating this outrigger as type 2? Are you getting my question? So here in this type 5, we have an outrigger, and this outrigger we maintain the changes using type 1 SCD. Why not type 2 SCD? Because it is always recommended to maintain the changes using type 2 SCD in data warehouse. Why this outrigger is of type 1 SCD? Why not type 2? Because it's a view, okay? Because it is maintaining current record. And if I say current record would be one, right? This is one thing. Second thing is, if we maintain this outrigger as type 2, then we would need to add a separate row in this table. And when we link this outrigger with customer dimension, then we have to create a separate row for the customer as well. That means, so the problem was monster dimension, right? In order to get rid of monster dimension, we divide this monster dimension into two dimensions. One is the base dimension and the another one is the mini dimension, right? So if we maintain, I'll explain you by using an example. So considering these two tables, dimension table, one is the customer table, second is the outrigger table. So if I say this outrigger table is of type 2, so type 2 means I need to maintain all the changes in my table. So whenever there is any change in any of the attribute value, then I need to create a separate row in this table, right? So if I do so, I am connecting this table with the base customer table using a foreign key, right? So suppose there is a record in this outrigger table which is connected with, let's say the key for this record is 1. The surrogate key for this record is 1, and this is an outrigger. And there is a base table, right? Which is a customer table. Here in this base table, it has its own surrogate key as well as it is maintaining a foreign key which will point to this table. Which will point to this table. So in case there is any change in any of the attribute in this table, then if I maintain these changes using type 2 dimension, then I need to create a separate row for this, right? And when you create a separate row, then you have to link this change with this by replacing this foreign key. Else, let me just share my screen, otherwise it will be difficult to explain this concept. So I was explaining this. So here we have there is the option for state box. I'm not finding. But there is no option to use this pen. Somebody suggested me to, if I share my desktop, then I can easily write the things and it would be immediately visible to you. Because here there is a time lag. Okay, I'll explain the concept here only. So I was explaining this outrigger is of type 1. So whenever there is any change in any attribute value in this table, then I can simply override that value, right? Which is type 1. Why not type 2? Since we always recommend to record the changes using type 2, so why don't we use type 2? Change here in case of outrigger. Yeah, and whiteboard option is also there, but again there is a lag. If I write something on the whiteboard, then it would be visible for you after 40 to 50 seconds. It will take 40 to 50 seconds to get visible for you. Okay. So if I create a separate row, then I need to link this change with my customer table, right? And you know, each record can maintain only one foreign key. So in order to link this change, link this new record or new row with my customer table, I need to create a separate row by repeating all the attributes, but my foreign key would be different, right? So every time there is a change in the outrigger table, so you can map these changes with the main base table, customer table, by creating a separate row for the different foreign key. That is why we prefer to use type 1 outrigger here rather than, you know, changing the attribute values and adding new rows in the customer as well as outrigger table. So that will again result in a large table. Right, large number of records in the table. So that is why we prefer to use type 1 outrigger. So type 1 outrigger means there is a customer table, there is an outrigger which maintains the current details of mini dimension, and this is directly linked. Outrigger is directly linked to the customer table by using a foreign key, right? And this outrigger is of type 1 because we have to, you know, we don't need to create a separate row in the customer table as well as in this outrigger table for maintaining those changes. Otherwise, if we maintain these changes by using type 2, then it would result in a large table. Again, we'll create the same problem from where we started. That is monster dimension. Okay, so here foreign key, if I say foreign key, so foreign key is the key which is used to map two tables, right? So each table has a unique key which is a surrogate key. Now when you map this table with any other table, then you have to use this key as a foreign key in other table. For example, let's say we have two tables here. Let me try whiteboard as well. So let's say we have two tables here, right? This is table 1. And this is another table, T2, right? So in T2, we have a primary key, which is a surrogate key in case of data warehouse. So we have surrogate keys. And here we again for this table, table 1, we have a key which is a surrogate key. Now you want to link this table 1 with table 2, right? So you need to provide a reference of table 1 in table 2, and that can be done by using the concept of foreign key. In order to link the records in two different tables, we use the concept of foreign key. So in table 1, we have a key, which is, let's say, K1. In table 2, we have a key, let's say, SK2, right? Now, I want to refer a record in table 1 from this table 2, then I will make use the concept of foreign key. Foreign key is this key, which is K1 in table 1, right? If I say any record where the key value is 1, seriously, difficult to write something here. So if I need to link two records, so I can make use of this key. That's a foreign key. I'm slightly confused with it's the admission primary key and hence. See, primary keys are the keys which have some inbuilt meaning, right? And they have some coded information, right? Whereas in data warehouse we use the concept of surrogate keys, and surrogate keys are meaningless keys. They don't have any hidden information, right? They are simply a sequence of integers. And now the question is, why do we use surrogate keys? Why don't we use primary keys? Because in OLTP system, we use the concept of primary key, but here we use the concept of surrogate keys. And I've already explained to you the reason why we use surrogate keys, which are system-generated keys. Whereas primary keys are the intelligent keys, they have some meaningful information hidden. For example, if I say your bits ID, so your bits ID is a primary key which can tell so many meaningful information. Your department code and your the year in which you took admission and other details, right? And here we have surrogate keys which are system generated keys. And this is this question is really important. Why do we use surrogate keys? Why not primary keys or meaningful keys in data warehouse? I have already explained. So here, in order to link two tables, we use the concept of foreign key. So I was explaining, so here in type 5 dimension, I use type 1 outrigger, and the reason being so that I would not end up in a large table. Now where to use? When there is a need to access the current values. So here we maintain outrigger just to maintain current values. If I need to access current values, so I can directly map customer table with my outrigger, right? I don't need to go via fact table, because when you create a mini dimension is connected with the base table via fact table. So every time whenever you need to join these two tables or the records which are given in these two tables, you have to go via fact table. So just to avoid this, we create an outrigger, which is a V, and which mainly stores current information. So it will optimize your query performance as well whenever you need current values, current records. Yes, we are maintaining records in mini dimension. This outrigger is simply a view. This outrigger is simply a view. This is of type 1, because here we are mainly focusing on the current values, right? We are not storing historical values here. And all the history, all the records, all the changes we are maintaining in mini dimension. So if you look at these tables, outrigger as well as mini dimension, so we have all the attributes which are same: profile key, age span, purchase frequency score, income level. Here also we are maintaining income level, purchase frequency score, age span, profile key. The only difference is here we are maintaining only the current information, not historical information like we do in OLTP systems. And why do we create? So that we don't need to we don't need to go via fact table in order to join these two tables whenever we need to fetch any current record. So it solves two purposes. You don't need to go via fact table to join with this merge mini table, and second purpose is you can directly retrieve a current record corresponding to a particular corresponding to any row or record. You can directly retrieve current values. So this is the purpose of creating OutTrigger. Can't we join it to mini dimension directly? Yes. So mini dimension you cannot directly join. You can you have to go via fact table, and you know the size of fact table is too large. The size of the fact table is too large. It will take so much time to, you know, join these two tables, customer table, which is my base table, with mini dimension table via fact table, because fact table itself is very large. So it will take much time to process a query whenever I need to join these two tables, customer with mini dimension. OutTrigger is mainly used to represent, it's a view, right? It's a view. And it is mainly used to represent the current records so that you can directly link your customer table with the current records. Whenever you would need current details about the customer, so you can directly link your customer record with this view, which is an OutTrigger. Now, what is view? Question is, what is view? OutTrigger is also a part of your mid-semester syllabus. Now, what is a view? View is a virtual table. View is a virtual table, right? You can combine data values from two or more tables and you can create a view. Anytime you can create a view. So view is a virtual table. So current profile count can be found out in the absence of fact table metrics. That's the advantage of using mini dimension with type 1. Now type 6, next is type 6. So type 6 is a combination of type 1, type 2 and type 3. So if you do the summation of these three types, type 3, type 2, type 1, you will get 6. If you multiply these three numbers, 3 into 2 into 1, again you will get 6. So type 6 is a combination of type 1, type 2 and type 3. And we'll see how we store the record using type 6. So type 6 is also used for maintaining history. So here, look at this table, first table. In first table, we have stored a record, right? Under different attributes. Now, in table 2, there is a change. There is a change in the department. There is a change in a department. So now the department has got changed to strategy. Earlier, it was education department, right? So here, we are maintaining both the details. Historic department team as well as current department team, which is what this is type 3. So in type 3 SCD, we maintain current record as well as last value of any attribute, right? So this is type 3. Now whenever there is any change, we add a new row in the table. So now the department has changed to strategy. So in order to record this change, we are creating a separate row. So this is what creating a new row in a table is what type 2 is what type 2 SCD. Now you are overwriting the values. So in this row, earlier, the current row indicator was current for this record. Now it has changed to expired. So we are overwriting the values. And this is what type. This is type 1. So here we are using all the three SCD types, type 1, type 2, and type 3, in order to maintain the changes in the records. Is it clear? Now again, there is a change. row in the product dimension following second department reassignment. So here it was education. Now, okay, yeah, we are updating this value as well. Now the current department name is strategy. So here in this table, we update this current department to strategy. This is again type 1. So this is type 1. We are updating this value. Earlier it was current for this record. Now it is expired for this record. So these are type 1 changes, right? Type 3, we are maintaining two versions for the same attribute, historic as well as current value for the same attribute. So this is what type 3 says. And we are creating a new record or row for every change. This is what type 2. So this is type 6. This is type 6. See, historic department, when I say historic department, so my type 3 change says what is my current value and what was my previous value. It maintains limited history, right? It maintains limited history. It should have retained education. Yeah. So, see, in this record, my historic value was education. Now, the new value was so that I can easily make out the comparison. I can easily make out the comparison with my current record, between the current record and the previous record. Right? If I want to compare the performance, I can easily do that by using type 3. That's why I'm maintaining historic as well as current information. If I say historic is the previous information. For example, the department has changed to strategy. So earlier it was education. So whenever there is any change, for example, now the strategy department has changed to critical thinking. So my previous department would be strategy, not education. Type 7, which is dual 1 and dual type 1 and type 2 dimension. Now, what is type 7? So, in type 7, it is a hybrid technique which involves two-dimensional database objects. So, if you look at this schema, so we have a fact table, we have a product dimension table, and we have current product dimension table where the current row indicator is current. So it stores only current information. It stores only current information. So here we are creating two versions of the same database object. So here we have a product dimension and we are creating two versions of the same dimension. One is actually the main product dimension and the another version is a view. Another version is a view of the product dimension where this current row indicator is current. Current row indicator is set to current. So it stores only current information. What are the advantages of using type 7 is I can easily retrieve my current records. Right? I can easily retrieve current records. Because there is a view that stores only current information. Whereas in product dimension, this is of type 2 SCD. This my product dimension is type 2. Type 2 SCD. So whenever there is any change in any of the attribute value, I'll create a separate row in my product dimension table and I can maintain those changes, right? Whereas here this is a view which stores only current information. So whenever there is any change in the product dimension, I create a separate row in the product dimension table. And in this current product dimension, which is my view, I simply override the information in order to represent the current detail about a record. So this is the difference. So product dimension is type 2 and current is type 1. It's not type 2 because here we are focusing only on the current information. it's clearly mentioned over here. Current row indicator is current. Here we have current product dimension, current department. So it always points to, it will always point to current record. See, product dimension, I'm maintaining all the changes in my product dimension. I'm maintaining all the changes in my product dimension. So the benefit of maintaining this current product dimension is whenever I need to fetch the record wherein I need to report the current version of the SCD attributes, I can directly point to this table. So whenever there is a frequent need to report on the current version of the SCD attribute, then there is no need to scan this entire product dimension table, right? I can easily retrieve the values from the current dimension, current product dimension. That's the purpose. Because in product dimension, I'm maintaining all the changes. So for one record, there is a record in this product dimension table, right? For the product key, for the product natural key, let's say the natural key of the product is 1234, right? Now next time, after a month or so, there is a change in the product description, right? So for maintaining this change, I have to create a separate row in product dimension table. Let's say after 3-4 months, there is a change in the department. Now this product has moved to some other department. So there is a department change. Again, I have to create a separate row. So for every attribute, for every change in the attribute values of the product dimension, I have to create separate rows. And this might be possible that there can be 100 rows for the same product, which maintains attribute changes about the same product. So there can be 100 records, there can be 150 records, there can be 1000 records. Whenever there is a change and you are using type 2 SCD, so every time you have to create a separate row in order to maintain this change. Right? Now you want to execute a query wherein you would need the current version of SCD attributes. So rather than scanning this entire table which stores large number of records, I can directly fetch the record using this view of product dimension where I'm storing only the current information. That's the thing. Now this is a summary. Just go through the summary. Another dimension is the time dimension. Why do we have a separate time dimension? And you have noticed when I was discussing retail sales case study, so there also we created a separate dimension, which is a time dimension. In most of the star schemas, you would have noticed that there is a separate dimension, which is a time dimension. Why do we create separate dimension, which is a time dimension in most of the star schemas? What is the point of creating separate time dimension? So time dimension is a unique and powerful dimension in every DM and EDW. Time dimension is very special and should be treated differently from other dimensions. Because time dimension, why do we maintain a separate time dimension? Because here we are dealing with the historical records as well, right? Whereas in OLTP system, we always maintain current records, right? Whenever there is a change in any attribute value, we simply override that value because we don't need to maintain historical records. Whereas in data warehouse, we maintain historical records as well. We maintain historical as well as current record, right? So we would need a separate dimension, which is time dimension. Other advantages of using this, let's say this is a time dimension. Other advantages of using this time dimension is I don't need to write complex queries in order to retrieve different details for a particular date. For example, let's say date is given as an attribute in any table. Date is given as an attribute in any table. So I can retrieve day of the week, day number in month, day number overall, month, month number overall. I can retrieve quarter information as well from my date attribute, right? But why do we create a separate time dimension? So that I can optimize the performance of my query instead of writing the complicated query, instead of writing any complicated query for retrieving different information about date from the date attribute value. I can easily fetch these details from my time dimension. That is why we create a separate time dimension. Another benefit of creating a separate time dimension is, let's say, considering this dimension, here we have an attribute which is quarter. So this quarter might be different for different organization, you can say, right? So this quarter value might be different for different things, right? Let's say in organization, quarter one is from January to, but quarter it will remain same. Let's consider this attribute fiscal period. So fiscal period might be different for different domains. So in one organization, I consider fiscal period is from January to December. In another organization, I consider fiscal period from April to March, right? So this might be different. So that is why we are maintaining a separate dimension. There is another attribute, holiday flag, weekday flag. So holiday flag can be different. Right, weekday flag cannot be retrieved or holiday flag cannot be retrieved from the date itself. That is why we maintain a separate time dimension. Another benefit of maintaining the separate time dimension is we don't need to learn complicated T-SQL functions, right? So if time dimension is already there in your schema, you can directly retrieve the values. You don't have to know how to use T-SQL functions. Another benefit is you can do point in time analysis as well if there is a separate time dimension. Shouldn't these flags be part of junk dimension table? See, in junk dimension table, we maintain those attributes wherein the cardinality of the attribute is very low, and these attributes do not directly belong to any dimension, right? So they can be considered in different dimensions. So for example, there is a flag attribute which can be considered in different dimensions, right? So instead of maintaining this attribute in different dimensions, I can create a junk dimension wherein I can put all the attributes which do not directly belong to any particular dimension. Rather, they can belong to multiple dimensions, right? So there we create the use of this junk dimension. Is it clear? So here, holiday flag will point to the time dimension only. So I can maintain this holiday flag in time dimension rather than creating a separate dimension, junk dimension for this holiday flag. And second important point is, when we design this dimension model, we try to keep our model as simple as we can. That is why we use the concept of star schema, not snowflake schema. Otherwise, it will snowflake schema will complicate your model. Though the data would be normalized, but it would be difficult to understand the model, right? If you are using snowflake schema, right? So the main purpose of creating dimensional model is it should be as simple as it can. And the second important feature is it should be easily understandable by the business users, right? Now the next topic is data warehouse bus architecture. So when you design a data warehouse, so you need to create a architecture kind of a thing which helps you to design a data warehouse. So we cannot build the enterprise data warehouse in one step. So this is Kimball's methodology. So as per Kimball's methodology, we have discussed two important methodologies given by Ralph Kimball and Bill Inman. So as per Kimball's methodology, we can create a data warehouse from the multiple data marts, right? But that is not always possible. We would need another architecture or a data structure in order to make it possible, which is what you can create a data warehouse from the data, from the different data marts. So what is this data warehouse bus architecture? So you cannot build the enterprise data warehouse in one step. Building isolated pieces will defeat consistency goal. So if I am creating different data marts independently, and if I was asked to join all the data marts to form a data warehouse, so I won't be able to create a data warehouse from the independent data marts. Because of inconsistency. Because I am creating each data mart independently without considering the consistency requirement. So I cannot simply join two or more data marts together because of the lack of consistency. So in order to design a data warehouse, we need to make use of this data warehouse bus matrix. And what is this data warehouse bus matrix? So I create a matrix kind of a structure wherein I identify all the business processes or the processes which would be required for creating a data mart. I can identify those processes. I can identify all the dimensions that can be used to create this data mart for a particular business process. And I can create this matrix kind of a structure wherein I can map the dimensions with a particular process. For example, for any organization, I have identified all the business processes. So business processes are issue purchase orders, receive data warehouse deliveries, warehouse inventory, receive store deliveries, store inventory, retail sales forecast, etc. Right? And for each business process, I have identified different dimensions which can be used. So date dimension would be used, product dimension would be used, warehouse can be used, store dimension can be used, promotion dimension, customer dimension, and employee dimension. These are all possible dimensions that can be used in different business processes. Now this cross represents that date dimension would be used in this business process, which is issue purchase order, right? Now product dimension would be used in this business process. Warehouse dimension would be used in this business process. Now store dimension won't be used in issue purchase order. So once I have created this matrix, I can start working on designing individual data marts wherein I can make use of these common dimensions, which are also called as confirmed dimensions. So if date is used in different data marts, so I'll create one date dimension which covers all the attributes which can be used in different business processes. And instead of creating different date marts, date dimension for all the data for different data marts, I create one date dimension which can be used for all the business processes. And the advantage of using this is, first advantage is when I create a common dimension, I don't need to maintain separate tables for depending on the usage. For example, date is used in issue purchase order, let's say order date, right? Receive warehouse deliveries, so receive date, delivery date, right? So there can be different dates in different contexts, right? So for every business process, you create different date dimension, right? Rather than creating different date dimensions for each business process, I create one date dimension which can be used in all the business processes by the concept of view. And this is the concept of confirmed dimension. And why do we use this? So that I can easily join two or more data marts in order to form a data warehouse. If we use these confirmed dimensions. So the rows of the bus matrix corresponds to business process, which is data marts. Creating the data warehouse bus matrix is very important upfront deliverable of a data warehouse implementation. The data warehouse bus matrix is a hybrid resource technical design tool project management tool and communication tool. So during architecture phase, team designs a master suite of standardized dimensions and facts that have uniform interpretation across the enterprise. So separate data marts are then developed adhering to this architecture. So once I have identified this metric, I can start working on creating separate data marts that should adhere to this architecture. And the main advantage of using this is so that I can join these data marts to form a data warehouse. So by defining a standard bus interface for the data warehouse environment, separate data marts can be implemented by different groups at different times, and the separate data marts can be plugged together and usefully coexist if they adhere to the standard. The facts would be different. Facts would depend on the business process. So facts would be different. So there will be a different fact table. There is a concept of confirmed fact, but it's not that important. Confirmed dimension takes 80 to 90% of the effort. Identifying the confirmed dimensions. Standardized facts were. It designs the master suite of standardized dimensions and facts that have uniform interpretation. So, as I just said, there is a concept of confirmed fact, but we mainly focus on the confirmed dimension. There is a concept of confirmed fact. If I use any fact value, if I use if I use any attribute value which is pointing to a particular thing, so it should point to that particular thing wherever I make use of this attribute. Right, if I say sales quantity, right, which represents to the sales quantity, and if I use the sales quantity in other schema, so I mean sales quantity only, right? I cannot use the sales quantity name in other fact table which are pointing to some other thing. If I say sales quantity, it means sales quantity throughout my data warehouse in all the data marts. So that's confirmed fact. But it would be difficult to identify confirmed dimensions. So there is a concept of confirmed dimensions. So confirmed dimensions are identical, strict mathematical subsets of most granular, detailed dimensions. Confirmed dimensions have consistent dimension keys, attribute column names, attribute definitions, attribute values. If two data marts have dimension, example customer and product, that are not confirmed, then they cannot be used together. So this is the main purpose of creating a confirmed dimension, so that we can join two or more data marts, or we can use two or more data marts together. That's the main advantage of using the concept of confirmed dimension. Now, multi-value dimension. Another important topic is multi-value dimension. So I have explained you star schema, where there is a fact table, centralized fact table, which is surrounded by number of dimension tables. So different dimensions, dimension tables are there, and there is a centralized table, which is a fact table. And this is, my fact table stores all the numerical facts. And dimension tables stores the information about different dimensions, be it a product dimension, be it a customer dimension, be it a store dimension, be it a promotion dimension, right? So dimension table provides context to this fact table. Now, one important point which we which should be noticed is the relationship between a fact table and dimension table. The relationship between a fact table and dimension table. So it should be many to one. It should be many to one. So the relationship between a dimension or in like other way around, if I say the relationship between a dimension and a fact table is 1 to many. Relationship between a dimension table and a fact table is 1 to many. Yeah, this was there in a quiz. Okay, so the relationship between a dimension table and a fact table is 1 to many. If I say 1 to many, what does it mean? It means a record in a fact table should point to only one record in the dimension table. There can be multiple records in the fact table which points to one record in the dimension table. For example, let's say fact table stores order details, right? So our order, any record in the fact table should be record to this fact table stores order details. So let's say quantity is a fact, and now relate this quantity with the product dimension. So if there is a record wherein I am maintaining the quantities, number of quantities sold for a particular product, so I can maintain multiple records or multiple rows in my fact table which tells me the number of quantities sold in different time periods, right, for this particular product, or number of quantities sold for this particular product in different locations, right? So there can be multiple records in the fact table, but each fact table record should point to one product dimension, right? A table should not point to multiple records in a dimension. So yeah, the relationship between the dimension table and fact table, it should be 1 to many. Now, what will happen in case the relationship between a fact table and dimension table is many to many? If I say many to many, how will you represent this this relationship on a schema? In case the relationship between a dimension and a fact table is many to many, that means what? Many records in the fact table will point to many records in the dimension table. How will you represent this information in a dimensional model? So that's the concept of multi-value dimension. It occurs when a fact table row may need to refer to more than one row in a dimension table. What happens when a fact may be related to more than one instances of a dimension? For example, more than one salesperson can collaborate for an order, right? So in case there is a fact table which stores my order details, which is order fact table, and one record or order detail related to a particular order is pointing to multiple salesperson, or multiple salespersons were involved for processing this order, right? So more than one salesperson can collaborate on a multiple order. So this relationship is what? This is a many to many relationship, and many to many relationship is represented by this symbol, crow feet. And this is how we represent many to many relationship. This is my fact table, and this is my dimension table. And this crow feet represents the many side of the relationship. So how will you represent this relationship? Now, there is a concept of bridge table. So now the possible solutions for representing this multi-valued dimension. First solution is we can place more than one key value in the fact table. This is one solution. So here, this is my fact table. Let's say two salesperson can collaborate for a particular order. So I can maintain two foreign keys in my fact table, which foreign key one will point to one salesperson and foreign key two will point to So I'm maintaining two foreign keys, foreign key 1 and foreign key 2. Foreign key 1 in the fact table is pointing to one sales person. Foreign key 2 is pointing to another sales person. This is one solution. What are the pros and cons of this solution? So pros are it will solve my purpose of representing multi-value dimension, right? Cons are it is not scalable because it will increase the size of my fact table. One drawback. Second drawback is in case any record is pointing to, let's say, three salesperson. So I cannot maintain three separate columns, foreign key 1, foreign key 2, foreign key 3 in my table. Let's say if I maintain three separate columns, considering any exception wherein an order has been processed by, let's say, five salesperson. So I cannot maintain that information in my table. Right, so this is not a viable solution. Another solution is bridge table. This is important. Bridge table. So bridge table, it relates the fact table and a dimension table. There is a structure, there is a special table which is called as bridge table, and this bridge table is a table which connects a fact table. There is a bridge table in between. It connects the fact table with dimension table. So bridge table lies between a fact table and a dimension table. And where do we use this concept of a bridge table? Wherever there is many to many relationship, right? And this cannot be many to many relationship cannot be represented. So because in a dimensional model, the relationship between a dimension and a fact table is one to many. So we cannot represent this many to many relationship. So there is a concept of bridge table in order to represent such relationships. Kishori, I don't have any example table for first approach. I can, you know, explain the concept here only. So in first approach, if I say a fact table is pointing to two instances, same record, a record in a fact table is pointing to two instances of the dimension table. For example, this is my order fact table, and this is my sales rep fact or dimension table, right? For the same order details, for the same row, this row is pointing to two instances of my dimension table. Okay. So first solution is I can create, rather than creating one foreign key here which points to the particular record in the dimension table, I am creating two foreign keys here in my fact table. So foreign key 1 will point to one instance in the dimension table, and foreign key 2 will point to second instance in the dimension table, right? This is first solution, but this is not a viable solution because first point is we have to maintain large number of foreign keys in case large number of sales representatives are involved, right? In case we have a static number, let's say only two sales representatives are involved, so we can create two foreign keys, right? In any exceptional case, let's say for any particular order, let's say three sales representatives are involved. How will you represent this information in this table, wherein we are maintaining only two foreign keys, which points to only two records of the dimension table? So there is, we have confined this, right? There is a limit. There is a constraint. It can point to only two records. So that is why this is an And another thing is, it's not a viable approach because it will increase the size of your fact table, and it cannot maintain all the relationship. In case there are four sales rep involved for processing any order, then I cannot represent that information in my fact table, wherein I maintain two foreign keys for FK1 and FK2. That is why this approach is bridge table, which is important, right? Now, what is this bridge table? Bridge table lies between a fact table and a dimension table. So, bridge table connects the fact table with the dimension table, especially for multi-value dimensions. So, this is an example. Oh, sorry, this is the first example. Okay, so diagram is there. Sorry, my bad. So, you can go through this diagram. Let's say two sales representatives are there. So, for this is the key for one instance. And this is the key for another instance. Or another way, first solution is you can create a different aliases or views for the same dimension. You can create different views or aliasing for the same dimension. That is another approach. But again, the drawback is, in case three sales rep are involved for processing any order, so you cannot create, you know, three aliases. And here also in order fact table, you have to maintain number of foreign keys as well. In case there are three sales represented, then you should maintain three foreign keys in the fact table. So this is not a viable approach. Now this is the second solution, which is a bridge table. So bridge table is the table which lies in between the fact table and the dimension table. And here we are maintaining two attributes. One is group key, and another one is the key attribute which points to the records in the dimension table. For example, let's say order fact. My fact table stores order information. Sales rep table, which is a dimension table, the source information about the sales representatives. Now this is the bridge table. So here in bridge table, I'm maintaining two attributes. One is sales group key and the second is sales representative key. So in case the order has been processed by, let's say, two sales representatives, whose surrogate key is 222 and 333. So I will create a group key which will remain same for all the sales representatives which are involved in processing an order, right? So let's say for this transaction, there are two sales representatives involved, right? So by using a bridge table, I can maintain this information. I'll create a group key for these two sales representatives. And so in one row, it will point to one sales representative. In another row, it will point to another sales representative. So this way, this table is connected with this dimension table. And here, with this fact table, I will simply connect this fact table with my bridge table using a group key. So in case four sales representatives are involved, then I have to create four rows in my bridge table wherein the group key would remain same for all the four rows. And the sales rep key would be different for different sales representatives. Let me just quickly finish this. So role-playing dimension, so is it clear this is the concept of bridge table? Now role-playing dimensions, again the same thing. You can relate this concept to the confirmed dimension. For example, if any schema, you would need, let's say, three date dimensions, right? Order date, due date, ship date. So instead of maintaining three different date dimensions, I create only one date dimension, and I can do the aliasing, or I can use views of the state dimension. That's role-playing dimension. So everywhere, wherever you would need this information, you can create a view for different purposes. So for order date, so there is only one date dimension, you can create a view or aliasing for order date, for due date and for ship date. So this is role playing. This is role playing. So rather than maintaining different different dimensions for different contexts, I'm maintaining only one dimension, and I can use this dimension for different contexts using the concept of view or aliasing. So this is all about role playing dimensions, and these topics have been covered in much detail in the recorded session. Fact-less fact table I have already explained to you. So fact-less fact table, it points to the event which happens when the intersection of different dimensions. So it points to an event which occurs at the intersection of different dimensions. When different dimensions come together at a particular point in time, they represent an event which should get captured, and there is no numeric fact associated with this event. So these events are stored in a table which is called as fact-less fact table. So in fact-less fact table, as the name itself says, we don't have any factual information, we don't have any numeric information associated with the fact table. So this is the fact-less fact table, and this is important. I have already explained you this, so I'm just quickly reading this. Fact-less fact table can be used to analyze what did not happen. So I explained this concept when I was explaining retail sales case study. So there was a query, how will you find the number of products that did not sell and these products were under promotion? So how will you find the products which are under promotion but did not sell? So we can make use of fact-less fact table in those cases as well. So fact-less fact table can be used to analyze what did not happen, and how will you execute this query. So these queries always have two parts. One is fact-less coverage table, which points to the, which contains all the possibilities of the event that might happen, and an activity table that contains the event that did happen, right? When the activity table is subtracted from the coverage table, the result is the set of events that did not happen. And this topic is really important, fact-less fact table. So I request you to please go through the recorded session, because this topic has been covered in much detail, right? So just go through the recorded sessions as well for the fact-less fact table. And this is your mid-semester syllabus. This is your mid-semester syllabus. So we'll be taking 5 to 10 minutes, a 10 minutes break. I'll just quickly walk you through the through this mid-semester syllabus. What are the things which you are supposed to study, and what are the things which have been covered in the sessions? So I'll just quickly walk you through the mid-semester syllabus. And one important thing is, your mid-semester your course handout is available on eLearn portal. So please download your course handout from the eLearn portal itself. It is already available, right? So we'll take a short break. Oh my God! So whatever I just said regarding the topics which we covered and part of your mid-semester syllabus, so that part has not recorded. So only those who are attending this class, only they know what are the topics which are part of the mid-semester syllabus and what type of question you can expect. Yeah, this is same for a regular as well as makeup exam. Okay, so there are two broad types of database activities. We have OLTP and we have OLAP. OLTP is online transaction processing, wherein we perform short transactions, which involves a small portion of the data. A small portion of the data needs to be scanned, right? Whereas in OLAP queries, which are online analytical processing, no, this is not a part of your mid-semester syllabus. Module 6 is not a part of your mid-semester syllabus. This will come post mid-semester, right? Now, OLAP, online analytical processing, wherein we need to perform complex queries in order to do analysis, and it scans large portion of the data. And here, the updates are very infrequent, And why do we perform OLAP in order to discover patterns and trends, right? And these are also called as decision support queries, which helps you taking strategic decisions. Now, from tables and spreadsheets to data cubes. So in tables, we have we represent the data in a two-dimensional format. Similarly, in a spreadsheet, we represent the data in two-dimensional format. In data cubes, we represent the data in n-dimensional format, right? N-dimensional is multi-dimensional view. So this is a 2D view of a table wherein we have two attributes, so this is time dimension and this is item dimension, right? Home entertainment, computer, phone, security. So this is your x-axis and this time is your y-axis. This is the 2D format. Now, we are asked to represent the data in a three-dimensional format. So that can be represented by a series of 2D tables, right? So this is for location, Chicago. This is one 2D format for location equal to New York. So this will store information where the location is New York. This table will store the information where the location is Toronto. So here I am representing three dimensions, which are, so my dimensions are location, items, and time. And these values are my facts. These are my facts. So the value which is stored in the table are my facts. So this is a logical view of three-dimensional. Wherein three dimensions are there, and this 3D data is represented as a series of two-dimensional tables. So this is 3D representation, wherein we have three dimensions, time, item, location, and the measure is a fact, which is what? Which is dollars sold. And this is the 4D cube representation. So 4D cube representation, so I can, so it's easy to represent three dimensions using a cube, right? How about 4D? In case we add one more dimension, how will you represent that fourth dimension using a cube? So here cube in general represents three dimension, x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, right? But here in data warehouse, if I say cube, so cube is a metaphor for representing multi-dimensional data, right? Otherwise, in general, cube represents three dimension, but here, if I say cube, in context to data warehouse, it represents multi-dimension. It gives you multi-dimensional view. So if we represent four dimensions using this cube representation, so 4D can be represented as a series of 3D cubes. So this is my 3D cube. And my fourth dimension, let's say my fourth dimension is supplier. So supplier is equal to supplier 1, supplier is equal to supplier 2, supplier is equal to supplier 3, right? And these are 3D dimensions. So 4D can be represented as a series of 3 dimensions. Similarly, we can represent n dimension as a series of n minus 1 d cubes. So that's data cube. Now, what are cuboids? So cuboids are, so in data warehouse research literature, a data cube such as each of the example is referred to as cuboid. So we have seen 3D, 4D. So each of the this data cube is also called as cuboid. So given a set of dimensions, we construct a lattice of cuboids, each showing data at different levels of summarization or group by. And the lattice of cuboids is called as data cube. Okay, so just look at this figure. So here, let's say we have four dimensions. We have four dimensions to analyze: time dimension, item dimension, location dimension, and supplier dimension. So I can create different cuboids. 0D cuboid, wherein I'm considering all the dimensions, right? That is the summarized result, most summarized result. So here all means all, let's say this is for, my fact table is quantity sold. Fact here is quantity sold. So this 0D, this 0D cuboid, it represents total quantity sold for all items across all location by all suppliers. So this is the representation. This is how we interpret this lattice of cuboids. So 0D cuboid, which is apex cuboid, it represents the total. It represents the total. So if I say total, I'm considering four dimensions: time dimension, item dimension, location dimension, and supplier dimension. So for all the four dimensions, if I say apex cuboid, so this apex cuboid stores the information about all items across all location for all suppliers, and I'm considering time, let's say, for the last 10 years. I'm maintaining history, I'm maintaining records for the last 10 years. So here for time, my time dimension would be last 10 years. So I'm considering all time, all item, all location, and all supplier. That's apex cuboid, which stores total summarized result. 1D cuboid. 1D cuboid, one dimension is there. If I say time dimension, which means what? For all time, what is the total quantity? Total quantity sold. If my numeric fact is quantity sold, right? So if I consider this 1D cuboid and this across time, which means what? Total quantity sold across all time. Item is total item sold for different location, for supplier, and all. So again, going back to the previous slide. So here, 3D cuboid for time. So if you consider this 3D cuboid, 3D cuboid wherein I'm considering three dimensions at a time. So it can be either identify all the possibilities. So it can be either time, item, location, time, item, supplier, time, location, supplier, etc. Where in three dimensions, I'm considering three dimensions. So what does it represent? 3D cuboid for time, item, and location, it represents summarized for all supplier. Summarized for all supplier, which means what? This will store the results wherein I have a time dimension, item dimension, location dimension, and this numeric measure, which is quantity sold. Quantity sold by all supplier for this particular time, for this particular item, for this particular location. Quantity sold grouped by all suppliers. I am considering all suppliers. This is what 3D cuboid represents. If I say 3D cuboid for time, supplier, and location. So it means what? This cuboid will store the total quantity sold for a particular time by a particular supplier for a particular location for all items. For all items. So this is what 3D cuboid represents. Similarly, 2D cuboids. So in case of 2D cuboids, if I say item, supplier, so this represents the total quantity sold for a particular item by a particular supplier for all time across all location. So this is the representation. This is the representation. So I have already explained to you in OLAP, we can drill down the information, we can roll up the information. I'll explain to you what is drill down and roll up. So OLAP is a software that helps you to do this analysis over data warehouse. So till now we have studied data warehouse. Why do we create a data warehouse, and what is a data warehouse, and what does it stores, right? So a data warehouse stores data which we extract from multiple heterogeneous sources and we put this data at one place, which is a data warehouse. This is the role of data warehouse. Data warehouse is a kind of a repository which is used to maintain the data which we collect from multiple heterogeneous sources. Now, what is the next step? Next step is we can do analysis. How will you do analysis on this data warehouse? So there we use the concept of OLAP tools. So OLAP is a category of software technology that enables analysts, managers, executives to gain insight into data through fast, consistent, interactive access to a wide variety of possible views of information that has been transferred from raw data to reflect the real dimensionality of the enterprise. So considering this architecture diagram, since I have already explained to you, so we have multiple sources, multiple heterogeneous sources, and we extract the data using ETL process, and we put this data in a data warehouse. So once we have this data, which is there in, which is stored in a data warehouse, then we identify OLAP tools, which are used to perform analysis, right? Which are used to perform data analysis. So data OLAP and data warehouse, typically OLAP queries are executed over a separate copy of working data, which is data warehouse. Why run OLAP queries over data warehouse? Why not OLTP system? Because data warehouse collects and combines data from multiple sources. Data warehouse may organize the data in certain formats to support OLAP queries. And OLAP queries are generally complex and they may require to lock the database, right? So if you lock the database for a longer period, then it's not feasible. It's not a feasible approach in case of OLTP system, where we maintain the changes or where we maintain the records, insertion, deletion, updation on a real time basis, right? So it's not a feasible approach. That is why we create a separate repository there, which is a data warehouse on which we can execute OLAP queries. And why do we execute OLAP queries? Just to do analysis. So our main purpose of maintaining this data warehouse is to get inside information, to get some important information, or the information which helps you in a strategic decision making, right? So OLAP versus data mining, again, these terms are used interchangeably, but there is a difference between OLAP and data mining. So OLAP summarizes data and makes forecasts, whereas data mining discovers hidden patterns in data, right? So for example, OLAP might pinpoint problems with sales of car in a certain region, but the data mining could then be used to gain insight about the behavior of individual customers in the region. So OLAP queries are used to access summarized or aggregated information, right? Whereas data mining is used to identify hidden patterns or some important information from the data, from the data set. So it is one level higher than OLAP. So I would say data mining is one level higher than OLAP. These terms cannot be used interchangeably. OLAP and data mining are different. And here is a link, so you can go through this link. Now possible OLAP queries, these are the possible OLAP queries. How did HP laptop sell in the last month? Did this product sell better in different regions? Are there any regional trends? Were there more returns of laptop over the last year? So you can execute such queries. And these are OLAP queries wherein you need to consider where you need to scan a large number of rows or records in order to get the results for these queries. And this is the multi-dimensional view. Now Hypercube. Hypercube is a representation that accommodates more than three dimensions. So it is just a representation. It's a metaphor for representing multiple dimensional data. For example, you need to represent 4D data. So wherein time is one dimension, items is one dimension, matrix is another dimension, and location is another dimension. So there are four dimensions. So this is the way of representing a multiple dimensional data. That's the concept of hypercube. In case somebody asks you what is a hypercube, so you can easily tell that it's a representation of for multiple multi-dimensional data. Now Cott's rule for OLAP. So Dr. Cott has defined so many rules for identifying the OLAP tools for your organization. So it's your OLAP tools should provide you multi-dimensional view. So if there are multiple dimensions associated for any business process, so your OLAP tools should provide you multiple dimensional views. For example, if I want to analyze the sales of a particular product in a particular region at a particular time by a particular supplier, so I should have this facility, right? So that I can analyze this data across multiple dimensions, right? Here multiple dimensions are involved. So my OLAP tool should provide me this feature so that I can analyze the data. I can analyze the data multidimensionally. It should be transparent. It should be your OLAP tool should be easily accessible, right? It provides access only to data that is actually needed to perform a specific analysis. It should provide consistent reporting performance irrespective of the size of the data, right? In case the data database size grows, so the performance should not get impacted, right? It should conform the system principles of client-server architecture. Generic dimensionality, which is what ensures that every data dimension is equivalent in both structure and operational capabilities. The tool cannot be biased towards any dimension. It should handle sparse matrix, right? In case there are less number of values, so it should have the tendency to deal with that. Multi-user support. Your tool should support multiple users at a time concurrently. Unrestricted cross-dimensional operation. It should provide you the facility so that you can access dimensions. You can access a cross-dimensional operation. You can do cross-dimensional operations such as drill across. Intuitive data manipulation you can do. Flexible reporting can also be, it should provide you the feature for flexible reporting, right? You can manipulate the data, you can do analysis, right? Unlimited dimensions and aggregation levels. So you can add as many dimensions as you can in your data set, right? So it should provide you, all OLAP tools should provide you this facility. So these are the 12 different rules which were provided by Dr. Cott. And if you want to identify an OLAP for your organization, so you can check your OLAP tool against these rules, whether your OLAP tool is providing these, whether your OLAP tool is satisfying these rules. So this is an analysis session. So suppose an analyst wants to identify why there is a profitability dip in the organization, right? So how will you perform this analysis? You have data which is stored in your data warehouse, and you have different dimensions. You have location dimension, you have time dimension, and you have other dimensions as well. So how will you identify this query, right? So the objective for this analyst is to find out the reasons for a sudden profitability dip in the organization, right? So this data analyst drill down this information. It fetches the records for the last 5 months, and it was found. So when he or she extracted the record for the last 5 months, it was found that sales was okay, but still there is a profitability dip in the last 3 months only, not 5 months. There is a profitability dip in last 3 months. Okay. So one thing I have identified by using this data analysis, that this profitability dip is in the last 3 months. Now I will again drill down the information. Location wise, right? In which particular location there is a profitability dip. So once I drill down the information location wise, it was discovered that there is a sharp dip, there is a sharp reduction in European region. Now again, I'll perform a query. I will identify why there is a dip in the European countries, right? So it was found that direct cost was okay, because of indirect cost, there is a dip. Then again, I will drill down data set, and I can identify that additional tax is one of the reasons for this profitability dip. So this is an example, like for analysis, like how do you perform analysis? If there is any objective, so how do you perform analysis on your data set? Right, so your data should be represented in a multi-dimensional view, so that you can perform data analysis. You can consider multiple dimensions, and you can do this type of analysis. Right. So this example is given in Paul Rajpumi. I have taken this example from Paul Rajpumi, and these are the features of OLAP tool. It should be multi-dimensional. Drill down, roll up. So we'll discuss this in more detail. So how OLAP system works. So you have created a data warehouse, then we use OLAP tools, right, in order to extract out information from the data. So data stored in a data warehouse. So we have ROLAP and we have MOLAP architecture. No, this is not a part of your mid-semester syllabus. This will not come in your mid-semester. This will not come in your mid-semester. Now, I'll just quickly explain you OLAP operations. This is important. So we have roll-up operations. So roll-up is, suppose this cube is given and you want to roll up. Roll-up means I want to move one level up the hierarchy. If I say roll-up, roll-up means moving one level up the hierarchy. For example, you have a location dimension, right? In location, it can be street, one level up is city, one level up is state, one level up is country. So you can do the analysis on this concept hierarchy. You can identify the information street-wise, you can identify the information city-wise, you can identify the information state-wise, and you can do the analysis country-wise. So this is the concept hierarchy. And if I say roll-up, so for example, information is stored for different streets, right? I can roll up it to cities. If I want to know the information, if I want to get data about city-wise, for example, I want to see the sales of the TV units which are stored in my table, right? So I want to do this analysis city-wise. So let's say for ABC, for Mumbai, how many units were sold in Mumbai? How many units were sold in Delhi? So I want to do this kind of analysis, which is city-wise. So my data which is stored in my data set is street-wise, so I can roll up this to city, right? In case I want to do analysis state-wise, I want to analyze the number of units sold in each state, right? So I can roll it up to state-wise. So OLAP tool provides you this facility that you can roll up, you can move one level up the hierarchy. That's roll up in OLAP. And this is the query syntax. Here we use this roll up. And please note, this OLAP, such as cube, rollup, the operators which we are using, so these are added to SQL 99 in order to perform OLAP operations. Cube operator aggregates the fact in each level for each dimension in a given OLAP schema. Now considering this example, select year, brand, some quantity from sales group by rollup. Here is brand, right? So here roll up would return the total quantity sold across all brands. So when I execute this query, what will be my outcome? For example, I want to analyze this number of quantities sold for each brand, considering let's say car brand. So if I perform roll up, so how will my table look like? I want year information, I want brand information, and I want sum, which is summation of quantity, right? So for, let's say for year 2008, brand is Mercedes. Number of Mercedes units sold, number of Mercedes cars sold, let's say this is 200. In year 2008, brand is Maruti. Number of cars sold is 100. In year 2008, brand is BMW. Number of cars sold is 400. Right? So I want this information year wise, brand wise, right? And number of quantity sold. But when you do roll up, it do the this operation does the aggregation. So this roll up does the aggregation, which is what it will show me the result, aggregated result. So brand null, and which is aggregated result for the year 2008 is the summation of for all the brands. So which is 400 plus 100 500 plus 200 700. Similarly, it will do the same for 2009. So this is roll-up operation. Roll-up operation is, I have this data stored in year, this data is stored year-wise, brand-wise, and if I do the roll-up, so I can do the aggregation. So roll-up operation would return the total quantity sold across all brands. And this is important. So query calculates the standard aggregate values specified in the group by clause. Then it creates progressively higher level subtotals, moving from right to left through the list of grouping columns. So here, moving from right to left, brand is there, year is there. So I can aggregate the information from brand and then to year. Finally, it creates a grand total. Don't worry, this is just for explanation, right? The SQL 99 and this, these queries won't come. This is just for the explaining the concept of roll-up, right? So for performing OLAP operations using SQL, there are certain operators or the keywords which you can directly use to perform such operations for executing OLAP queries. Drill down. Drill down is, you can go down the hierarchy. Suppose you want detailed information. I have summarized information. I want detailed information. I know in year 2008, number of cars sold for all the brands is 1000. But I want segregated information. I want to analyze the number of cars sold for each brand. For BMW, for Mercedes, for Maruti. So I need to drill down this information, right? Based on brands. So this is drill down. When you move one level down the hierarchy, that's drill down. And again, this in the SQL, we have a keyword which is roll down for performing this drill down function, right? Then we have a slice. Slices, I can remove the chunk of the data, right? Based on one dimension. I can select the value for one dimension and I can retrieve the result. So this slice selects one particular dimension for a given cube and provides a new subcube. So here slice is Q1. So for Q1, so I want to analyze the data which is wherein one dimension is location and another dimension is mobile phone for time equal to Q1. That's slicing. Dicing, wherein I can give two or more damage attribute values. For example, location is either Toronto or Vancouver. Time is either Q1 or Q2. And this is the data queue. This is the data queue I get from this data queue, right? So this is dicing. And then pivot. Pivot is, suppose you want to rotate your table. So since you are dealing with multi-dimensional view, you might want to rotate your table. You want to see location on x-axis, and item on Y. So that you can do by using pivot. And these are OLAP operations drill down. Suppose this information is given to you, wherein different items are given and the total sales are given, right? Now you want to see these clothing sales in different years. So what was the sale in 98, 99? So that means I need to drill down. I need to drill down because I'm moving one level down the hierarchy. So from the summarized information, I want some detailed information, right? Now I want to see this result wherein this should be time should be my y-axis and these items should be on x-axis. So I can perform pivot operation. And these are the examples. So these examples we will discuss on next term because it is already 5. It's already 6 o'clock. So all the best for your mid-semester exam. So module 1 to module 5 will be your mid-semester syllabus. Don't get confused. Module 1 as per your course handout. And course handouts are already available on Takshila or eLearn portal. You can easily download those course handouts. In case you are not able to download course handout from the eLearn portal, just drop me an email. I'll share the course handout with you. Yes, first 1 hour of today's session is a part of your mid-semester syllabus. Thank you. When you say course handout, no. Course handout is so this is your course handout. This is your course handout. It's not PPT. If I say course handout, so course handout is this thing. So there is a tab in eLearn portal, course handouts. This is your course handout. Context session 1, what are the topics we were supposed to cover in context session 1? Then in context session, what are the topics we are supposed to cover in context session 2 and so on. So this is the course handout. Live lectures will be sufficient. I request you to please go through the recorded sessions as well. Live session as well as recorded session would be sufficient for your mid-semester. And especially for this unit, module 5. Live sessions as well as recorded sessions. Because module 5 is too detailed. Module 5 is too detailed. Thank you.